religious. So the whole past life thing and soul and the soul level and the higher self and us being close to God and reincarnation, it's all evil. Right? I was brought in a house where this was all evil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I'm sure that the back pain is from around that issue. Mm-hmm. Like if I can disconnect from, like if I was still attached with the umbilical cord with my mom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just had that mm-hmm. vision.
Yeah.
I want to cut that cord. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Even though I've got all these burdens, all these burdens trapped in my lower back.
Even though I have all these burdens trapped in my lower back.
I have to be the good girl.
I have to
hold the burden.
To
make my parents happy.
Make my parents happy.
My brother abandoned them.
My brother abandoned them.
And I feel my parents' pain.
I feel my parents' pain.
The burden of the responsibility.
The burden of the responsibility.
To not upset them.
To not upset them.
It's still trapped in my back.
It's still trapped in my back.
And even though I have this pressure on me.
Even though I have this pressure on me.
This burden. To please my mom.
To please my mom.
To please my parents.
To please my parents.
And not upset them.
And not upset them.
I accept myself.
I accept myself.
And the way I'm still attached by the umbilical cord.
The way I'm still attached with the umbilical cord.
I want to release it and let it go.
I want to release it and let go.
My parents' beliefs.
My parents' beliefs.
Their religious beliefs.
Their religious beliefs.
I was brought up. By their religious beliefs.
By their religious belief.
And they don't believe in guides and higher self.
They don't believe in guides and higher self.
And the spiritual stuff that I believe in.
And the spiritual stuff that I believe.
To them it's evil.
For them it's evil.
And part of me wants to honor them.
And part of me wants to honor them.
And not upset them.
And not upset them.
And I feel the burden of that.
I feel the burden of that.
In my lower back.
In my lower back.
I feel the burden of that.
I feel the burden of that.
Through my umbilical cord.
Through my umbilical cord.
That goes all the way through to my back.
That goes all the way through to my back.
That pulling.
That pulling.
That wanting to honor their ways.
That wanting to honor their ways.
That wanting to honor their beliefs.
Wanting to honor their beliefs.
Wanting to honor my own.
Wanting to honor my own.
That conflict.
That conflict.
Trapped in my umbilical cord.
Trapped in my umbilical cord.
My belly button that goes all the way through to my lower back.
My belly button that goes all the way back. My lower back.
I accept myself and the pain and conflict I'm feeling.
I accept the pain and the conflict and feeling.
And I ask my body to release it now.
And I ask my body to release it.
All my soul connections.
All my soul connections.
My soul history.
My soul history.
With my parents.
With my parents.
Especially my mom.
Especially my mom.
Even my brother.
Even my brother.
This soul play that we're playing.
Their soul play with as our.
This soul play that we're playing.
Their soul play that we're playing.
I want to release all the pain.
I want to release all the pain.
All the burden.
All the burden.
Still trapped in my lower back.
Trapped up in my lower back.
I want to cut the umbilical cord.
I want to cut the umbilical cord.
All the fears.
All the fears.
That I'm not being a good daughter.
That I'm not being a good daughter.
If I choose to believe in my own beliefs.
If I choose to believe in my own belief.
It's time to cut the cord.
It's time to cut the cord.
And without hurting mom.
And without hurting mom.
It's time for me to cut the cord.
It's time for me to cut the cord.
Asking my guides and higher self.
Asking my guides and higher self.
And the guides and higher self of my mom.
And the guides and higher self of my mom.
Asking for permission.
Asking for permission.
Giving permission.
Giving permission.
It's time to cut the cord.
It's time to cut the cord.
Asking them to use beautiful golden scissors.
Asking them to use beautiful golden scissors.
Filled with love.
Filled with love.
To cut the cord.
Can we have a chainsaw filled with love?
Chainsaw filled with love. The cord's very thick.
It's very thick. Mm-hmm.
soaring through that core. With minimal pain. And with lots of love. Honoring the soul connection. Honoring the soul purpose. Honoring the soul lessons between us both. That we both set up. It's time for me to breathe on my own. It's time for me to be my own person. This soul is evolving. Into my own power. Into my own beliefs. And even though they're not my parents' beliefs. I ask their guides and higher self. To release their belief. That what I believe in is a sin. Allowing them to see the higher soul picture. Allowing them to honor my journey. Allowing them to honor the way I'm growing up. Allowing them to be proud of who I am. Even though my beliefs differ from theirs. Allowing love. To fill the hole. Where the umbilical was. In me and in my mother. Sending love. Honoring her beliefs. Even though they're different to mine. And asking her to honor mine. As I honor my own beliefs. And stand tall. Releasing the burden. Of having to please her. And be the good little girl. She has her own soul learnings and lessons. She has her own issues to walk through. And it's not my responsibility. I don't have to hold the burden in my lower back. The burden of being a child. The burden of being a mother. Releasing all that pain and burden. From my lower back. From my umbilical cord. From my body. From my soul. And all my souls. And all my lifetimes. Especially the lifetimes. When I've spent. Soul lessons with my mother. And her soul. Releasing and letting go. All of the burden. Deep breath. How does that feel when you picture your mother now?
More love. And respect.
And how about your back?
It's hard to say. Because I don't feel anything like that. I wasn't when I entered here. It's always like that. When you go to the doctor, you don't suffer anymore.
So it's usually in the mornings when you get up that you get back pain.
Yeah, and sometimes when it's have more bad days when it will stick for the whole day.
Can you remember a bad day where it stuck for the whole day? What was going on?
It was recently.
Do you know when it first came on?
Yeah, I remember.
What was that?
Well, to be honest, I remember, I'm in the military. I started to feel pain. I was training in Gagetown. I was to become an artillery officer. And I can remember that one day I was in the field, and I mean, it was just annoying me in my lower back, but it went quick. I was young, and maybe, I don't know, I mean, with the time, it just went
So when you were bigger in the field with the, yeah, with the artillery, were you carrying a lot of things?
Was there?
Well, yeah, we had the backpack and all the mm-hmm, all the equipment that goes with it. Mm-hmm. So I could remember having a bit of pain there, and then I remember another time when I was an artillery officer and we're training up in Valcartier, Quebec, and the whole day I had like this back pain, and again when I was doing a course, I was learning how to shoot in a armored vehicle, so I had the training to operate the turret and then fire from there, and then I had the pain there. And the most vivid memory of that is when I was deployed to Afghanistan the first time, and we did training in Fort Drum, New York. And we arrived on site, and we were just unloading everything, and all our weapons were packed in bags, like 10 in one bag, so we could cross the border, and it was easier for, it was the law anyway. And I picked up one of those bags, and it was just a wrong movement, and it snapped, my back snapped, and I was literally crooked for like 3 days, and I couldn't move, and I couldn't do anything. I went to our field hospital. They gave me like pain pills, but I couldn't go back home because I was in New York, and I had to go to the training, so I was sitting on a chair, and I couldn't move for like 3 days. Mm-hmm. I was just in pain, and then it went away. And then it started happening more frequently. It was just pop, and then I would be off for like 4 days, and then it would come back. And then one time it happened again, and then the pain just stuck. And it was just, at some point, it was like maybe a 1 out of 10, and then it would go back to a 10, and it was just doing this. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm, yeah.
Even though I've got this pain in my lower back.
Even though I get this pain.
That varies from 1 to 10.
That varies from 1 to 10.
And I'm not really feeling it right now.
I'm not very really feeling it right now.
But I feel it more in the mornings.
I feel it more in the mornings.
And sometimes it's really hard to get up.
Sometimes it's really hard to get up.
I accept myself and all this pain.
I accept myself and all this pain.
This pain that I received the first time.
This pain that I received the first time.
The first time I noticed it.
The first time I noticed it.
Out in the field.
Field.
When I had my weapons and my backpack.
When I had my weapons and all my gear.
All my gear. Backpack. All that weight.
All that weight.
All that pressure on my back.
All that pressure on my back.
Training for fighting.
Training for fighting.
Training for war.
Didn't really like it anyway.
Mm. Training for war.
For war.
Part of my body not liking it.
Part of my body not liking it.
I wonder where I've been in a war before.
I wonder where I've been in a war before.
Asking my Akash.
Asking my Akash.
All the lifetimes I've ever lived.
All the lifetimes I've ever lived.
Tuning into the multidimensional layers of my DNA.
Tuning in the multidimensional layers of my DNA.
Recognizing that I've been in war before.
Recognizing that I've been in war before.
That I may have even been killed in war before.
That I may have even been killed.
Tuning into the memory of my body.
Tuning into the memory of my body.
And my Akash.
And my Akash.
And my cells screaming out.
My cells screaming out. I feel like it's more of an internal war.
A what war?
An internal war. Not maybe a real war.
Mm-hmm.
That's the feeling I have.
That internal war.
Yeah. Internal war.
Training to be in the military.
Training to be in the military.
And not really wanting to be there.
And not really wanting to be there.
All that conflict trapped in my back.
All that conflict trapped in my back.
No wonder I had that pain on the field.
I wonder I had that pain on the field.
Carrying my backpack and all my gear.
Backpack and all my gears. It's like the memory of doing something against my will. Mm-hmm. Like if I had no choice.
Mm-hmm. That feeling that I had no choice.
That feeling that I had no choice.
When I had my military gear on.
When I had my military gear on.
I wonder if there's another lifetime.
I wonder if there's another lifetime.
When I had to go to war.
When I had to go to war.
Against my will.
Against my will.
When the government made me.
When the government made me.
Or I felt I had to.
Or I felt I had to.
That feeling of duty.
That feeling of duty.
Just like I feel with my mother.
Just like I feel with my mother.
That feeling of duty.
That feeling of duty.
That I have to do something against my will.
That I have to do something against my will.
I'm not truly believing what I want to do.
Not truly believing what I want to do.
What I have to do.
I have this strange feeling that, and I had the image before when I was about to book the appointment with you, that I was like, if I had a lifetime where I was, where my soul picked up that I need to have, because I'm pretty sure that the lower back is kind of connected with my sexual life as well. And I had the impression that I was a prostitute before.
Doing things against my will.
Maybe I was forced by my mother to do
things. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that feeling of being forced to do things against my will.
That feeling to do things against my will. Being forced to do things.
Yeah, that feeling of being forced.
That feeling of being forced.
Perhaps by my mother.
Perhaps by my mother.
Perhaps by my mother's soul.
Yeah, my mother's soul.
That I had to please her.
That I had to please her.
That feeling in my sexual area.
That feeling in my sexual area.
That goes through to my lower back.
That goes through to my lower back.
All the energy trapped there.
All the energy trapped there.
Of having to do things I don't really want to do.
Having to do things I really want to do.
Being forced.
The strange thing is, I was in need of money a couple of years ago. And the only solution I got. Maybe 10 years ago. And the only solution that I found is I went and I danced in bars. And I...
You did what?
I was a stripper.
Mm-hmm.
10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I worked in an erotic lounge where men were just touching my body and giving me my... Not sexual... I mean, no sexual relations, but still, I had to dance.
Yeah.
They were masturbating and looking at me and they couldn't touch my body.
Mm-hmm. That feeling that I had to do... What I didn't want to do.
Feeling I had to do what I didn't want to do.
That soul and cellular memory.
That soul and cellular memory.
That I still have in my body.
That I still have in my body.
I want to release it and let it go.
I want to release it and let it go.
All the way back to the lifetime.
All the way back to the lifetime.
When I was a prostitute.
When I was a prostitute.
When I was forced to do what I didn't want to do.
When I was forced to do what I didn't.
All those sexual memories.
All those sexual memories.
All that pain and conflict.
All that pain and conflict.
Trapped in my sexual areas.
Trapped in my sexual areas.
Trapped in my lower back.
Trapped in my lower back.
Re-triggered this lifetime.
Re-triggered this lifetime.
When I danced as an erotic stripper.
When I danced as an erotic stripper.
With all those men touching me.
All those men touching me.
Masturbating.
Masturbating.
I needed the money.
I needed the money.
It paid well.
It paid well.
But I have this conflict.
But I had this conflict.
I didn't really want to do it.
Didn't really want to do it.
Part of me screaming out, I didn't want to do it.
Part of me screaming out, I didn't want to do it.
Just like part of me was screaming out that I didn't want to fight.
Part of me screaming out that I don't want to fight.
Even though I joined the military.
Even though I joined the military.
When I was out on the field. All my gear.
And all my gear.
I had this conflict.
I had this conflict.
I didn't want to be there.
I didn't want to be there.
Like when I was in Afghanistan.
Like when I was in Afghanistan.
Lifting all of the guns.
Lifting all the guns.
All the artillery.
All the artillery.
My back recognizing it.
My back recognizing it.
Giving me the message I didn't want to do that.
Giving me the message I didn't want to do that.
The burden in my lower back.
And me not seeing it.
Yeah. My body's saying it for me.
Yeah, my body's saying it for me.
Thanking my back.
Thanking my back.
For giving me the message loud and clear.
For giving me the message loud and clear.
Because my mouth couldn't say it for me.
Because my mouth couldn't say it for me.
I choose to allow my mouth to speak up for me now.
I choose to allow my mouth to speak up for me now.
In every situation.
In every situation.
Where I need to speak up.
Where I need to speak up.
Where I want to voice my opinion.
When I want to voice my opinion.
Without fearing.
Without fearing.
What? How I'm going to be received.
How I'm going to be received.
Without fearing judgment.
Without fearing judgment.
Without fearing criticism.
Without feeling criticism.
Without worrying about other people's reactions.
Without fearing other people's reaction.
Without the need to please everyone.
Without the need to please everyone.
I choose to please myself.
I choose to please myself. And please my husband.
And please my husband. And I choose
in to another way. You got that.
Yeah. I choose to speak.
I choose to speak.
My truth.
My truth.
Wherever I am.
Wherever I am.
Without fear of criticism and judgment.
Without fear of criticism and judgment.
I release all the pain.
I release all the pain.
All the guilt.
All the guilt.
All the conflict.
All the conflict.
The feeling that I was made to do something against my will.
The feeling I was made to do something against my will.
Out of my sexual areas and my lower back.
Out of my sexual areas and lower back.
Through this lifetime and every lifetime.
Through this lifetime and every lifetime.
I instruct my Akash to release it now.
I instruct my Akash to release it now.
Releasing the guilt.
Releasing the guilt.
The conflict.
The conflict.
The feeling that I have to please others.
The feeling that I have to please others.
I can speak up for my own truth now.
I can speak up to my own truth now.
I'm not responsible for other people's reactions and opinions.
I'm not responsible for other people's reactions and opinions.
I have full choice at all times.
I have full choice at all times.
Releasing the guilt.
Releasing the guilt.
From my body.
From my body.
My sexual organs.
My sexual organs.
My lower back.
My lower back.
When I think about dancing.
When I think about dancing.
At Mars. Is that where it was? At Mars?
Yep.
When I release the feelings in my body.
I release the feeling in my body.
And all the memories of what I saw.
And all the memories of what I saw.
And what I heard.
And what I heard.
The looks in their faces.
The looks in their faces.
Them touching my body.
Them touching my body.
I release my guilt.
I release my guilt.
I earned good money.
I earned good money.
I release the feeling that I was forced to do something I didn't want to do.
I release the feeling of when I forced to do something I didn't want to do.
I chose to do it.
I chose to do it.
I earned good money.
I earned good money.
I choose to honor myself.
I choose to honor myself.
And honor my choices.
And honor my choices.
I'm not responsible for other people's actions.
I'm not responsible for other people's actions.
Opinions.
Opinions.
Rules.
Rules.
Beliefs.
Beliefs.
I choose to stand in my truth and my beliefs.
I choose to stand in my truth and my beliefs.
And I send that truth.
And I send that truth.
And my ability to speak it.
And my ability to speak it.
Through all my lifetimes.
Through all my lifetimes.
Especially this one.
Especially this one.
Letting my back know it doesn't have to speak for me.
Letting letting know my back it doesn't have to speak for me. Mm-hmm. Feels good just to talk about it.
Makes some sense, doesn't it?
It makes some sense. And then I had the first vision was when, I don't know, the image was like the movie Les Misérables. Mm-hmm. You've seen that movie?
Yes.
With the character, she has her hair all cut, and then mm-hmm. she had to put her daughter somewhere else, and then she's having sexual relations to just get the money.
Yeah.
So I had first this image that when I watched that movie, it
triggered you.
Yeah, kind of. And I was like, oh my God. And when I was a kid, I wanted to be a prostitute. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I wanted that. I thought it was cool having sexual relations all the time and having all that fun. I was a kid, right?
Yeah.
And then at the end of the tapping, I had the image that in another lifetime, more around maybe 17th century, 18th century, I was again a prostitute, but in a bar, more classy, and then I was kind of the pretty one. And then there was kind of a standing around being the favorite. And then I had a sense that I was pleasing men, and then I was recognized by, like, I was the one.
Yeah, you were the top one.
I was the top one.
So there was a pride in that.
Yeah, that's the word I was looking for. There's the pride in what I was doing. It made me feel alive. Mm-hmm. And then I remember growing up with that, mm-hmm. with the firm belief that you have to be pretty if you want to be successful. So if you're not pretty, then you're nothing. Mm-hmm. I had that for a long, long time, even a little bit again today, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. Even though I've had that belief growing up.
Even though I had that belief growing up.
That you have to be pretty to succeed.
That you have to be pretty to succeed.
And part of me still believes that.
And part of me still believes that.
And I thank my Akash for showing me that lifetime as a prostitute.
Thank my Akash for showing me that life as a prostitute.
When it was in a classy bar.
It was in a classy Western saloon type of bar.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And I was the top most sought after woman.
I was the most top sought after woman.
I was the prettiest.
I was the prettiest.
And everyone wanted to be me.
Everyone wanted to be me.
And I felt pride in what I was doing.
I felt pride when I was doing.
I accept myself. And this feeling and recognition.
And that feeling of recognition.
That I got when I was number one. The prettiest girl in the saloon.
The prettiest girl in the saloon.
I accept myself feeling.
And that feeling.
That was brought over into this life. That feeling, even when I was a little girl. That I wanted to be a prostitute. I wanted to be that pretty one. That leftover memory from another life. I choose to have pride in what I do. But I can release the feeling. That I have to be the prettiest one to do it. I choose to take pride in what I do well. And I release the connection. That it has to be through prostitution. Yeah.
Releasing that need.
All the way back to its origin.
Wherever it began.
Even to that time in the Western saloon. I take pride in what I do. But I don't have to be pretty to do it. I choose to stand in my own truth. And I release any pain and burden. Still trapped. In my lower back and my sexual organs.
Mm.
See how lifetimes can carry over. Because, you know, a young child growing up thinking that and wanting that, you know, there's no reason for that other than it's come through from your Akash.
Yeah, because I thought it was so cool, like you can have sex all the time. And then the sex was good, so you would have orgasm all the time. God, it doesn't work like that. Oh my God. And you know what's funny? I just had the memory. My mom used to do like volunteering work with one of her friend at the time, and she was helping prostitutes on the street in Montreal.
Mm-hmm.
They were delivering like a care package,
mm-hmm.
like soap, shampoo, toothbrush,
mm-hmm.
sanitary pads, tampons, and everything mm-hmm. for them to. Yeah, that's weird.
Mm. mm. So it seems like there's connection even in this lifetime through your mother, through, you know, to lifetimes of prostitution.
Mm. Mm. Maybe.
Mm.
Well, she had to, she once told me that it took everything just to have two children, and she had to, in order to stay with, well, she chose to stay with my dad and in this life,
mm-hmm.
and then she had to ask God to remove any desire from her body, because my dad was just not giving her
mm.
what she needed. He comes from a abusive kind of
background,
and he has problem in the sexual area.
Mm.
So my mom had to ask God to remove every desire from her body. So she chose that.
Mm.
But yeah.
Mm.
After the second kid.
Mm.
That she got the surgery to remove a disc when we were living in New Brunswick. I was like 2 years old. Three years old. She went to surgery to remove that disc. She has no problem with her lower back anymore. But,
Mm-hmm. okay. Even though my mother had problems with her lower back.
Even though my mother had problems with her lower back.
And perhaps I inherited and learned those patterns.
And perhaps I inherited and learned those patterns.
I give my body and my lower back permission to release them now.
I give my back and
my lower back
permission to release it now.
Everything that I learned from my mother.
Everything that I learned from my mother.
Her difficulty getting up in the morning.
Her difficulties getting up in the morning. Looking after her two kids.
All the pain in her lower back.
All the pain in her lower back.
All the pain in her body.
All the pain in her body.
That I watched and learned when I was little. I choose to release them and those memories from my lower back. All my mum's burdens and pain still trapped in my lower back.
All my mum's burden and pain trapped in my lower back.
I choose to release it now. From this lifetime and every lifetime.
From this lifetime and every lifetime.
Where I've held pain in my lower back.
When I held pain in my lower back.
When my body spoke for me.
When my body spoke for me.
I choose to speak my truth now. And I let my body relax. It doesn't have to speak for me now. Like it did in Afghanistan. I give my lower back strength. To hold me straight and tall. To support me in every way. As I stand in my truth. My lower back supports me. As my mouth speaks my truth.
I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you had that conflict of not really wanting to be fighting in Afghanistan, and when
you lifted. Didn't want to go to Afghanistan. It was just before you went. It was an awful tour.
Mm.
Like, psychologically, because I hated it.
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. The second tour was good, though. I liked it.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing different things, but the first one was just
So you've done two?
Yeah.
Mm. And are you still on the list to do that, or you're out of it now?
It's not the matter of being on the list or not. Mm-hmm. I'm still active.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on maternity leave right now, but I go back in February. I'm now doing public affairs for the military, so they would need to, usually they ask who's available, and as a public affairs officer, you're kind of an augmentee to a group, because there's like one public affairs or a small group of public affairs for a whole
mm-hmm.
headquarters or a whole group. So usually they will just take all those who were available to go, and then they would ask, like, and during your career you kind of have to go at least once, so they will see who's next and who's, and then they will ask. I mean, and if you say not interested and I want to go, kind of okay. Canada, you can.
Mm-hmm. So how does that feel with you to be able to stand in your truth and say, no, I'm not interested, I don't want to go?
Mm-hmm. I would be able to do it, mm-hmm. and say that for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not closed. I mean, I'm not, because Afghanistan is closed. We're not going there anymore. We took the troops out of there,
mm-hmm.
Last year.
Mm-hmm.
But if there was another mission, really interesting, I would put my name on it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Yeah. It's just that I have different plans. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm looking forward to retiring in 2 years after my 20 years contract, so I could do my coaching business,
mm-hmm.
full time.
Mm-hmm.
With EFT, hypnosis, and NLP and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
that's my plan.
Mm-hmm.
So I can help. I want to focus on managing stress and post-traumatic stress disorder to help those who went to Afghanistan,
yeah,
and
great.
Those who, all my brothers and sisters in arms that are suffering,
yeah.
from that.
Great.
This is what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Even
yeah.
though?
Even though?
My soul put me in the military.
My soul put me in the military.
For a greater purpose.
For a greater purpose.
So that I can help those with PTSD.
So I can help those with PTSD.
Because I'm one of them.
Because I'm one of them.
They'll accept me.
They will accept me.
They'll
yeah.
understand me.
They will understand me.
And I'll understand them.
And I will understand them.
I accept my soul's mission.
I accept my soul's mission.
And I thank my back.
And I thank my back.
For holding the pain.
For holding the pain.
And the conflict.
And the conflict.
And I release it completely now.
And I release it completely now.
Two more years of active duty.
Two more years of active duty.
I release and let go of any conflict.
I release and let go of any conflict.
And I see the higher learning and the higher picture.
And I see the higher learning and the higher picture.
For stepping into my coaching business.
For stepping into my coaching business.
Within 2 years.
Within 2 years.
As my young kids are a little older.
As my young kids are a little older. And I want more kids.
Mm-hmm.
I need a strong back to have more kids.
I need a strong back to have more kids.
Yeah, I need a strong back to have more kids.
I release all the pain and suffering still trapped in my back.
I release all the pain and suffering still trapped in my lower back.
Like my first pregnancy.
Like my first pregnancy.
That I lost at 19 weeks.
Like I lost it in 19 weeks.
All the pain still trapped in my back.
All the pain still trapped in my back.
All the loss.
All the loss.
All the sadness.
All the sadness.
I want to release it and let it go.
I want to release it and let it go.
And if that soul hasn't already joined me.
And if that soul hasn't already joined me.
In my two kids that I already have.
In my two kids that I already have.
I give permission for that soul to come back.
I give permission for that soul to come back.
And I thank it for the learning and the lesson.
And I thank it for the learning and the lesson.
And I release any pain and suffering and sadness.
And I release any pain and suffering and sadness.
And grief.
And grief.
That I still hold.
That I still hold.
In my lower back and sexual organs.
In my lower back and sexual organs.
And I choose to go back in time.
And I choose to go back in time.
To that me who first found out.
To that me who first found out.
That 19-week-old baby inside of her.
That 19 weeks old baby inside of her
had no heart beating.
Had no heart beating.
I let her know I'm her from the future.
I'm letting her know that I'm her from the future.
And I'm here to let her know she has two beautiful babies.
And I'm here to let her know that she has two beautiful babies.
And that she'll be free to have many more.
She'll be free to have many more.
Letting her know that soul has a choice.
Letting her know that soul has a choice.
It wasn't the right time.
It wasn't the right time.
There was a higher learning and a contract.
There was a higher learning in the contract.
It wasn't the right time.
It wasn't the right time.
Thanking that soul.
Thanking that soul.
For the connection we had.
For the connection we
had. That we will always have.
That we will always have.
And inviting that soul to come back.
Inviting that soul to come back.
Letting her know.
Letting her know.
She has two beautiful babies.
She has two beautiful babies.
And there's more to come.
There's more to come.
Letting her know all is well.
Letting her know all is well.
Tapping on her to release all the grief.
Tapping on her to release all the grief.
Letting her connect with her soul learning.
Letting her connect with her soul learning.
That this was planned.
That this was planned.
And it's okay to grieve and release.
It's okay to grieve and release.
Releasing that from her back.
Releasing that from her back.
All the pain and burden.
All the pain and burden.
Releasing that from her uterus.
Releasing that from her uterus. Yeah.
Sending her love.
Sending her love.
Allowing that soul.
Allowing that soul.
That was the 19-week-old baby.
That was the 19-week-old baby.
To send her love.
To send her love.
Having her whisper, remember we planned this.
Having her whisper, remember we planned this.
Remembering the soul planning.
Remembering the soul planning.
All is well.
All is well.
Releasing the grief.
Releasing the grief.
Feeling love.
Feeling loved.
Feeling the connection.
Feeling the connection.
So what happened when you found out that there was no heartbeat? Were you given drugs to have the baby?
I had to go through surgery.
Surgery?
Because it was, because of the stage and the size. So mm-hmm. It was, I don't know how to call it in English, when you just, you scoop it out.
Mm.
So, yeah, I had to go into the surgery.
Mm-hmm.
I was just like borderline of having to deliver it naturally. So I was glad that I could just go to surgery and just don't see anything. And
yeah.
Yeah.
So it was like a curette.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it went well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you remember waking up? How
yeah.
How did that feel?
Waking up from the surgery. It's not fun to wake up from a surgery.
Mm.
You feel thirsty and your throat hurt because of the tube they put inside. And it was all the blood coming out.
Mm.
Yeah. The exact same feeling when I had my first was a C-section. So it was the same feeling. Except that I didn't have a baby.
Mm.
And the second time I had one.
Mm-hmm.
With health.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
So when you think about that moment in time when you were told there's no heartbeat,
yeah.
How does that feel now?
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
So having that released from that area as well should have
all the facts going.
Yeah.
I don't kind of feel anything like
that. Mm.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's always emotions and burdens and grief and sadness and conflict of this isn't what I want to do. So many stuff that's held in uterus and back that's been of sexual nature or of mothering of umbilical cord stuff to your mother that we've just cleared as mm-hmm. well.
Yeah, it all makes sense.
Mm.
Like where the conflict can come from, and when I did my, and conflict is a great word for me, honestly, because when I did my depression, I did major depression. I was 27 years old, so that's 10 years ago,
mm-hmm.
and I was diagnosed as borderline. By a psychologist. So it's all about black and white all the time. So that conflicts. I mean, I've been living in conflicts all my life. Choosing always, it always had to be black or white. It couldn't be gray. Never. I would feel so uncomfortable in the gray area. It had to be. I couldn't deal with, like, with relationship with friends, and loved ones, I mean, my partners, that I couldn't understand in my mind that you say you love me, but then you would criticize me on something. So it was, that doesn't make sense. So every time I had a criticism or critiques or something, someone would look me with, or hate me, or being angry with me, it was, oh my God, so you don't love me anymore. And then it was until I could think about life's not worth it. So I should just commit suicide right now, right?
Yeah. Even though I had deep depression 10 years ago. And I had that conflict, that black and white feeling. That conflict of emotions. Like when someone said they loved me. And then they'd criticize me. And I'd feel their hate. I accept myself in this conflict of emotions. This black and white feeling. Just like I'm wearing today. This black and white feeling.
But there's some gray. I'm okay.
Maybe it's okay to feel gray. That in between. I didn't have that in between feeling. I wasn't able to stand up for myself then. That feeling of conflict. They love me, they don't love me. That feeling of being criticized. That misunderstanding. People can love me and criticize me. Maybe out of love. I choose to release my reactions to criticism. That things have to be black or white. I choose to embrace the gray area. And I send that information back to me 10 years ago. I let her know I'm her from the future. And that life is beautiful. That we have two children. And I've learned a wonderful husband, and I've learned to stand in my own power. And I'm giving you that gift. That ability to stand in your own power. To embrace the gray. And release the criticism. You're not alone. I help you to connect to your guides. And your higher self. And you're always connected to me. You have a bright and beautiful future. And I love you very much. Sending you that love. And tapping it into your body. Releasing all the depression. All the conflict. Filling you with love. We're always connected. I'm always there for you. Call me whenever you need me. How's that feel?
Good. Very good. It feels lighter.
And there's that connection with guides that are always there.
And as I'm pretty sure that when, I mean, working that connection, because I think it's a work in progress to be more and more in tune with them, that I'll feel lighter and lighter when that relation just
connects
more and more and more.
Yeah, and it's the same as anything. It's with practice.
Yeah.
Practice, and asking and requesting and giving permission.
The asking part. And that's when in the book it struck me, when Michael leaves his apartment and he doesn't know where to go. And then he's just wandering for like hours. And then finally sitting on the curb, he's like, Where do I go? Where are you? And then suddenly the angel just come in and say, where were you? Yeah. So where were you? Well, you didn't ask.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're waiting to be asked.
Yeah, and so many people in our days just assume that you can freaking read their mind.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to be one of them. I mean, oh, you should know how I feel. No, I mean, it's not written on your forehead.
Mm.
So you have to ask.
Oh, they know how you feel, but... Yeah, it's about asking for the resolution, asking for help, asking for what do I do now, where do I go?
Where do I go? And then believe in the signs, not discarding all the signs that...
Mm. And what's the higher learning?
Yeah, like that story, I don't know it by heart, but there's a great story where there's a guy who's just... There's all those bad things happening to him, and he believes that God would help him. And then it's just becoming worse and worse and worse until like he's on the top of his house sitting on the roof. And then like a helicopter is sent for him and he's like, no, God will provide for me. And then the guy dies and then he goes to heaven. And then God is like, well, I sent you this, and this, and you didn't
accept it.
So here you are.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a...
Yeah. Recognize the signs and the lessons. You know, they're not always when you think bad things are happening, like when you lost your first baby.
I asked myself, like, I knew there was a learning, but to identify it as like, it's hard.
Mm.
So I just stopped asking for a precise answer, and I was just, there's a lesson.
Mm-hmm.
So just live with it.
Mm, and feel the love of it. I had a miscarriage between my two kids, and when I did a regression with my trainer, the soul of the one I lost is my youngest, and he chose to come back and be my youngest, not the middle child.
Okay. I was told that my youngest is the one that I lost.
Mm-hmm.
And I was told that the first one was supposed to be a boy, although I didn't know because it was not far enough for me to know that. But someone who's connected into channeling told me it was a boy and he wanted to come back as a girl. He was just not ready and he was just confused sexually. So instead of coming to hurt and just be all conflict about, really? I just make a connection with that.
Mm.
Like me having conflict with the back and then what is really sexuality. And then my first born, my first unborn had the same conflict.
Mm-hmm.
And he left.
Mm. Mm.
Hmm.
Interesting, isn't it? Mm.
Yeah.
God. So now you've got no sexuality conflict.
Yeah.
There's a clear channel.
So is that the learning then, that you get to embrace your sexuality?
Mm.
Oh.
Mm. Be congruent with it and release any guilt.
Embrace who you are.
Mm.
So that baby couldn't, I mean, it was just too much, and then he decided to come back. Apparently it's my swan, my last one.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently he came back. The soul came back in the swan.
Mm-hmm. Good. So when you imagine getting up in the morning, when your back's usually painful, but you have no conflicts, you're embracing the grey, you're not having to be the good girl that pleases mum.
I just have to be.
And you're in your power and your strength. How does that feel?
It's peaceful.
Mm. Okay. And stepping into your beautiful power within a couple of years as well and building on that. So that in 2 years when you're out of the military, you'll be still within it, basically, by helping them. Yeah. Helping those with PTSD.
My project is called Warriors Emotions. Warriors Emotions. Yeah. And I say when the soldier thought the world was over, he became a warrior. So he conquers himself. They don't teach you in the military. I mean, they gave you your uniform. They give you your satchel and all your gear. So you're set. I mean, you have your kit. You have your weapons. You have your bullets. You have everything. But what happens if emotionally you're just not there? They don't give you a recipe for that.
Yeah, your truth and your wisdom. The book, The Journey Home, will help you with that project as well.
Oh, I'm
the warrior. The next house that he goes to.
And I'm there still. I mean, I just feel not. I don't feel ready to launch it right now. No. The warrior's emotion, and I don't feel that I'm ready to go to the military and present my project.
Yeah.
There's a missing piece that I need to find out what it is.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I mean, I'm doing all of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can
the
help.
The journey home is the missing piece.
Yeah.
There'll be others, but yeah, you're putting it all together, and that's great.
And I want to help kids as well. I think emotional freedom has to be learned as early as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm doing projects with that as well.
Mm.
So it's all coming together now. Mm. I mean, with my second born. Mm. I was told that this baby would push me forward and bring money into the house.
Mm.
Not only for the sake of having money and be rich and wealthy, it's just that's the purpose.
Mm.
Because I believe that more money you have, the more people you can help.
Mm.
Right?
Mm.
So.
Mm. Abundance all around.
Abundance, yeah. Not to be greedy, just to help more.
Mm.
So I can, I'd like those PTSD project to be free from military. I mean, you gave your life to the military, it should be free.
Yes.
But if I want it to be free, I need to earn money on the side. Mm. So I need to pay for my own things, right?
Mm.
So, yeah.
Beautiful. So just keep asking your guides to bring that in. This is your mission. This is your goal.
I need to be shown the way. Help. And the people who can help me with that.
Yeah.
They have started to show me. I mean, since end of April, have been amazing things happening to me and people.
Yeah,
of course, there's still a little fear around that, but it's normal. I'm a human, so
you're human. You just accept it. Yeah, that fear is there because I am human, and move through it. And the Journey Home book will help you with that.
Yeah,
because he has that it following him the whole way.
Mm-hmm.
That's fear.
Yeah, the green thing.
That's his human fear.
Yeah, yeah. And I want to teach the world about fears because they're good. Because they can protect you.
Yeah, but it's about recognizing them and letting them go.
Yeah. Good.
Mm, my turn.
Thank you.
You're welcome.